Today we are going to be talking about the Canon R6. Now I know you're thinking, it's been out for a while. Why are we doing a video on it now? But actually, this is the first time I've properly got my hands on it. We did an R5 video a few weeks ago, so I thought it would be nice to do an R6 video as well. Of course, as always, there's links in the description so you can check out the product for yourself. But this is an interesting one because where the R5 has really big headline spec, this one is a little bit more modest. But actually, I think that's only kind of on paper. You know, 4K 60 is still really nice, but it's not 4K 120, that kind of thing. You know, 20 megapixels instead of a really nice high res. But actually, like I say, I think when you actually come to use this, and I was less excited about using this than the R5, this is a really, really nice camera to use. So spoilers for the rest of the video, I've really enjoyed this. I might have enjoyed this more than the R5, which is something I didn't expect. So this isn't gonna be a super spec heavy, tech heavy video. I wanna talk a little bit about kind of how this is to shoot with, both for photo and for video, because this is a very capable hybrid system for photographers and for videographers. I wanna talk about things like image quality, obviously autofocus, the design and the build of it. We're gonna do a little bit of a comparison between the R5 and the R6 as well, but let's just dive straight into it. Let's first of all talk about that image quality. So like I said, 20 megapixel sensor, not as big as the R5. You know, some people might be thinking that's a little bit too small, but to be honest, I think it's perfectly fine. You know, there's still actually enough room to crop a little bit if you want to, but to be honest, it was kind of forcing me to, you know, really compose my images properly. You know, I can't rely on cropping so much in post. And it gave me, you know, really nice detailed images and actually really good low light performance as well. So even when the sun was starting to set and we weren't getting so much light because of the clouds and stuff like that, this was performing no issues. Bumping that ISO up, absolutely not a problem at all. Now, obviously, as you'd expect, you get those beautiful Canon colors. It just looks so, so good. And I've been out shooting with the RF kind of Trinity lenses. So the 15-35, the 24-70, and the 70-200, all f2.8, which, you know, some people might think, well, that's a little bit cheating because those are beautiful lenses. And I've got to say, they absolutely are. The image quality I was getting was, to be honest, stunning. So whether I was doing portraits, a bit of a landscape, you know, trying to capture people in a moment, it was just super, super good. The actual camera itself is, it's very, very comfortable. I think it's a little bit lighter than the R5. I don't actually have the weights in front of me here, but it certainly felt like it was very usable. You know, the grip is nice and deep, but the whole thing is not too big. You know, it's not too chunky, but it feels good. And with these lenses on there, really, really nice setup. In fact, let's talk about the actual camera design for a second, because there are some key differences, I think, from the R5, but some of them I actually quite like. So with the R5, of course, you've got that screen on the top, the little LCD screen shows you some of your settings. That's super useful. Here we don't have that, but we do have the mode dial on the top of the camera. And actually, I really like the mode dial. I know it's a really simple thing, but just being able to switch between different custom modes and, you know, manual and then aperture priority and all that kind of stuff super quick on the dial, really, really nice. There's a really nice kind of tactile feel to it, and I like it. You've got very ergonomic controls along both the top where you've got the shutter and then a dedicated movie record button, pretty much where your other finger might sit. You know, you've got the different dials, and I want to talk about that for a second because I've probably had the best manual shooting experience of my life with this camera because I've had three dials to play with. So I've got one with shutter speed, one for aperture, and one for ISO. So from just having my eye up to the viewfinder, I don't have to press any other buttons to get to ISO. I don't have to do anything like that. I can just adjust any of those settings straight away, super easy. Now that sounds like not a big deal because, you know, you just press one button to get ISO on a different camera and then you use the dial. But it really actually was noticeable. I really noticed it as soon as I kind of worked everything out that I was just using these three dials all the time while I was out shooting manually. And it meant I shot in manual pretty much the whole time. I didn't actually switch back to aperture priority or shutter priority or anything like that. I just stayed in manual. Now I do tend to shoot in manual a lot, usually though with a bit of auto ISO for various things. But here I wasn't using auto ISO because it was so easy to change it to where I wanted it to be. That extends to things like the touchscreen as well. Now I think this touchscreen is a tiny bit smaller than on the R5, but I didn't really notice anything. Again, it's a flip out screen. So if you wanted to film yourself, you could easily do that. I like a flip-out screen. I've mentioned this in a bunch of videos. I think they are really, really nice. But again, in terms of ease of use, having my eye up to the viewfinder, which by the way, looks fantastic, and being able to adjust the focus point, not with a joystick, but my finger on the screen, moving it around, so, so nice. Something that initially was a little bit jarring because I'm so used to a joystick, but actually really, really good. Of course, you have got the joystick control on there as well. No problem at all. So if you like using the joystick, that's there. But I did really like using the touchscreen for the focus point and things like that. Now, I can still do the 12 frames a second mechanical shutter, 20 frames a second in terms of electronic shutter. So it's still super fast like the R5. And that's a great thing to have in there. As an all-rounder camera, which is absolutely what this is, you know, video, photo, just doing all kinds of different things. That's great to have in there because it means you can use it for sport, you know, wildlife, all that kind of stuff where you need that super fast continuous shooting mode. It's nice to have in there. Now, it's worth mentioning it's pretty quiet in the way it shoots, but there is a little bit of shutter noise. However, that shutter noise, and I mention this whenever I notice that I love a shutter noise, I like to mention it in the review. I love this shutter noise. It's quiet, it's subtle, but it's there, and I like the sound of it. It just sounds good. Small thing, personal thing, but I personally really liked it. Now, while we're talking about the body of the camera, it's also worth talking about the card slots as well. Of course, dual card slots, as you'd expect now. We're not making that mistake again. But they are both SD cards. Now, is that a plus or a negative? Well, to be honest, it doesn't have the 8K, you know, the 4K 120, that kind of stuff that you get with the R5. So it doesn't need a CF Express card. It doesn't actually need that in there. So having dual SD card slots, I think is perfect. I think it allows you to do everything you want to be able to do with the camera. And to be honest, most of us own SD cards anyway. So it means you don't have to buy a new CF Express card. Of course, you've got that 5-axis image stabilization in the camera as well, really good for video shooting, which we'll come onto in a minute. Really good for kind of low light shooting if you want to use a slower shutter speed. Again, just like in the R5, it's probably some of the best image stabilization I have ever used. It's just very, very good at, you know, maintaining a steady shot. If you're shooting handheld video or something like that, it means that it's a video system. This is very usable for kind of running and gunning a shoot, for using handheld stuff, for client work. You know, you don't have to pop it on a gimbal. You're gonna be able to get those smooth shots, which is always a huge plus. You know, tends to be when I work with this kind of thing and I do video stuff, whether it's client-based or whatever it is, I like to run and gun a shoot. I like to be able to move around a lot and go quickly and change shots and do kinds of things like that. So the less I have to set up something like a gimbal, the better. I think a gimbal is a great tool to be able to use, but the less that I have to rely on that, the better. The more I can just do it in camera, perfect. Speaking of video, like I say, we don't have the headline specs of the R5, so no 8K, no 4K 120 either, but we do have 4K 60, which I think is still really good. I think that's still very, very useful. I would use 4K 60 a lot. You've got full HD 120, so if you want the super slow motion, you can absolutely do that. Do I wish it was 4K 120? Yes, of course. That's super cool. 4K 120 is super nice, but 4K 60 is still very, very useful. And actually, I don't know, and this is just from a personal point of view, I'm starting to get a little bit tired of just using 120 a lot. You know, I think I want to add a bit more speed into some of my videos. So actually, something like that would force me. That's just a personal thing. Obviously, I would love it to have 4K 120 as well because it's super good. But, you know, I don't think 4K 60 is the end of the world at all. You've still got full HD 120 as well. It's also worth mentioning that 4K is with no crop as well. So there's no crop on the 4K, which is nice. It means that you're getting good video here. And this is kind of what I mean by this is just such a good all-rounder. You're gonna get really decent video, really decent photo performance without kind of going crazy on specs, which then bumps the price up. So this is a fantastic alternative to something like the R5. This is a really, really awesome camera. Also, and this is worth mentioning because it was such a big deal with the R5, no overheating issues at all. So no matter what I was doing with it, I wasn't getting any kind of overheating problems at all. I haven't heard of any with the R6. And that is a big deal because obviously with the R5, that was a bit of a headline for a while, which isn't ideal, I suppose, for Canon. But with the R6, nothing. This is one of the reasons that I really like this camera a lot. You know, it's just very reliable. You know, you're gonna get good performance, good quality, Now, we haven't even talked about the autofocus at all. Of course, there's the dual pixel CMOS AF in this camera. It works just as well as you would imagine that it does. You know, face detection, eye detection, great. Portraits, fantastic. You know, I did portraits with the RF 70-200, a little bit of the 24-70 as well, even the 15-35. That face and eye detection works super well. The autofocus just in general, whether you're doing landscape or whatever you're doing, works super well, exactly as you would expect it to. At this point, it's more of a story if the autofocus doesn't work so well, but here, super good. For the price, I think this is a difficult one to beat, you know? This has got a lot of good spec in it without anything going super crazy. It just performs very well kind of across the board. Photo, video, image stabilization, autofocus, low light, all this stuff works really well, you know, without anything going crazy and exceeding everything else and then bumping that price up. So it keeps the price pretty reasonable. Of course, there's a link down in the description. It keeps the performance very, very good, very reliable. I like it. I'm a big, big fan. It's just very pleasant to shoot with. There's a lot about it that just works super well. And this feels like where the R5 is that kind of, you know, if you want 8K, if you want 4K 120, if you want super high res and stuff like that, the R5 is the one for you. If you don't want to spend as much, but you still want to get really good stuff and have good performance across photo, video, all that kind of stuff, this is a fantastic option. Now, do I have any negatives about it? Not in the sense of what is in this camera. I think that everything that is in here works very well. I think it works exactly as it should, and I think it's fantastic. Do I wish it had more in it? Kind of, but then that is just the R5. So I guess what would be the point, right? If you want all that stuff, it already exists, and it's the R5. Now, if you have any questions about the R6, of course, pop them down in the comments. I'd love to hear your thoughts as well. R5, R6, which one's the one for you? I'd love to hear what you think about this camera. I would love to hear what you think about these lenses, all that kind of stuff. So let me know down in the comments. If you enjoyed the video, of course, make sure to like and subscribe. That helps us out. We get, you know, new tutorials up every week, reviews of all kinds of stuff all the time, new products, fun products like this, all kinds of stuff. I will, of course, see you in the next video. And as always, thanks for watching.